Thank you. It's wonderful to be here in Christiana, which is truly beyond planet Xenon from what I've seen so far, which is fantastic. And I assume you're all here because you think organs on chips are hors d'oeuvres for the cocktails, but we will see. So it's really great to see all you people here. I love talking to the public. There's the big problem in the world that there's so much fear of science and technology, and I think it's really our only hope, and we need to get solutions going. So I hope you enjoy this. So I have been at Harvard for 34 years, and for the last eight, I've been the founding director of the Wyss Institute for Biologically Inspired Engineering. This is our logo. It's one of self-assembly because we started with basically me and a couple of other faculty, and we grew to about 375 full-time staff in about 3.5 years. So if any of you have been involved in startups, this is startups on steroids. A little backstory before I go into the talk. So the way this institute came about was I was asked by the head of the Harvard University to chair a committee to help envision the future of bioengineering across all of Harvard and the hospitals. And we got a group of scientists together, you know, world-leading scientists, and we realized that we are all collaborating with each other, we're all in different disciplines, and that essentially the boundaries between the disciplines have already begun to break down. And as a result, the boundary between living and non-living systems is breaking down as well. And so we look to the past, we saw bioengineering has transformed medicine over the past 50 years by taking engineering principles and trying to solve medical problems. You have hip implants, drug delivery, pacemakers, artificial hearts. You hear about genomics all the time, but what really changed medicine has been engineering. But we were tasked thinking 30 years in the future. And so when we realized that the boundaries are breaking down, and we looked and we realized that we've actually uncovered enough about how nature builds, controls, and manufactures from the nanoscale up, that we've actually hit a tipping point. We're actually at a point where we actually can leverage biological principles to develop new engineering innovations. This is what I call biologically inspired engineering, not bioengineering or biomedical engineering. And organs on chips, I think, are a great example of that. We were very lucky to get kickstarted with the largest single philanthropic gift in Harvard's history at the time of $125 million from Hans-Jürg Wyss. And actually, we doubled that 5 years later. The institute is tasked with taking on really huge problems that could have, if you could solve, would have incredibly high impact. And so when we started, we were involved in translation, going from basic science to starting companies to developing, enabling products to be developed that actually can change the world in just a matter of years. So it's a little different than the usual academic environment. So when we started, to me, the biggest challenge that I could see in medicine is that the drug development model is broken. And if you talk to the heads of major pharmaceutical companies, biotech companies, and you ask them what's their vision, they basically say failing quickly and cheaply. And this is because it costs so much money to bring a drug all the way through and then fail that they want to figure out how to do it sooner. But to me, that's depressing. Okay, that's not a vision. So I know a lot of you probably have heard of Moore's Law. How many have heard of Moore's Law here? All right, so this is that the computer power has doubled every 18 years since 1971 on a log plot here, just by miniaturizing microchips and coming up, transistors to microchips and so forth, and packing more and more information on a little chip. How many have heard of Eroom's Law? Eroom's Law is Moore's Law backwards, which is that the number of medicine invented has halved every 9 years since 1950 on a log plot, while the funding by governments around the world and pharmaceutical companies and biotech has gone through the roof. So there is a major problem here. Just an example, this is a plot, it's called bioavailability. This is if you give a drug, how much is actually goes into your circulation and can do something. This is what's predicted by animals, this is what they found in humans. There's absolutely no correlation. Yet, drug companies, have to use animals because the regulatory agencies require it. So why is it broken? Well, 3 years ago, there was a study that quantified this. It cost $2.6 billion to take a drug from a discovery to regulatory approval. Problems are that you start with cells in dishes that don't function or look anything like in our bodies. You have to do animal studies to get approved, to show safety, to show efficacy. They take years to complete. They're very expensive. You guys know the ethical issues of that innumerable animal lives are lost. But the big problem is that more often than not, they do not predict what happens in humans. A mouse is not a man. And so as a result, there are less drugs getting to patients. And so people have been searching for ways to mimic not cell function, but organ level function, and hopefully human body level function. So when we started the Institute, we were focused in six totally unrelated areas, from nanomaterials to bio-inspired robotics to synthetic biology. I started a platform we called Biomimetic Microsystems. It sounds scientific, right? So that's good. So the idea is to engineer microchips containing living human cells that can reconstitute organ level functions, not cellular tissue, but organ level functions for drug screening, diagnostic, and therapeutic applications, with this idea of accelerating drug development and replacing animal testing. So first question is, why microchips? I mean, that came out of nowhere. So microchip manufacturing offers control over features at the same nanometer to micrometer size scale that living cells and tissues live at. And for those of you not familiar, a nanometer is to a meter as the diameter of a blueberry is to the Earth. This is very tiny, okay? And so we started, and chips use photolithographic etching. If there are artists here, they know about lithography. You take a mask and a pattern, you put it on a chip that has silicon chip that has some polymer, you expose it to ultraviolet light. Some of the light is blocked by the mask, other part goes through, it dissolves the what's called a photoresist polymer layer, and you get little circles here. And then you can put chemicals down or metals in microchips, and then remove the polymer, and you get patterns. And about 25 years ago, George Whitesides, who's a very famous chemist at Harvard, and I started collaborating, because George had developed a way to make inexpensive microchips. So he would use photolithographic etching, let's say, to make this pattern of circles, but then he would pour a liquid on it that would polymerize and be a clear rubber stamp. And he would peel it off, and it would have the opposite pattern, and then he could stamp patterns of metals or chemicals, and you could make thousands of chips, which are very expensive because they have to be done in clean rooms, with one of these little rubber stamps. And we've had a series of breakthrough papers in Science and Nature where we could use this to pattern little adhesive islands that are on the size of individual cells. They're coated with what's called extracellular matrix. This is the materials that cells adhere to in your bodies. I like to think of them like an egg carton orienting eggs. In your tissues, there's a matrix, extracellular matrix, outside the cell matrix that they sit on, and they literally bind and pull on it and adhere to it. If you put it on a dish, they will bind and adhere. And the way cells stick and spread is they bind and they pull against it. They generate tension, just like in your muscles, and they pull and they spread and they flatten and they flatten. And so I have worked for 40 years that mechanical forces are as important as chemicals and genes. And I wanted to show that stretching a cell could impact whether its functionality. And so we used this and we made big circles and little circles surrounded by non-adhesive, you could think of Teflon-like region, all flat. And we put cells on it, and on the big circle, you get a cell flat like a pancake. And the same cell on the little circle is like a golf ball on a tee. And we could break this little circle into many dots, and the cells actually spread like a suspension bridge from dot to dot to dot. So it's as big as this cell, but it contacts the same chemical matrix material as this in terms of area. And we could show that these cells, in presence of growth factors, proliferate, whereas these cells go into a suicide program. And we could then put cells in the middle, and they would not grow or die. They would become specialized in liver cells, produce blood proteins. Capillary blood cells form tubes, muscle cells contract. So in any case, we were using this 25 years ago, and that's how we got into microchips, into biology. George started to make systems that have little channels in them like this, and it's called microfluidics. And this is what has miniaturized all sorts of instrumentation that used to be the size of a refrigerator, they're now the size of an iPhone. And it's used in hospital labs, analytical diagnostic devices. So to me, as someone who's trained in medicine as well as biology and worked in blood vessel vascular biology, These are like artificial blood vessels in that you can flow fluids through, and the size and shape of vessels. So we combined this all together in a creative play, and we created what we called a human breathing lung on a chip. Okay, so we started with the lung, and one of the major functional units of the lung is called the air sac or the alveolus. This is where you have gas exchange, pneumonia, metastasis of cancer, aerosol-based drug delivery. It's a major functional unit. If you look at it, it looks like a bunch of grapes with basically air in the center. If you cut this in cross-section, like you were cutting a loaf of bread in cross-section, and you go to a very high magnification, this is an electron micrograph, you basically have air. You have one cell that's your lung lining cell. It's called an alveolar epithelial cell. You have that egg carton, the extracellular matrix I told you about, looks like fuzz. And on the opposite side of the egg carton is the capillary blood vessel cell. And then you have blood. But what's not shown here is that we know from clinical medicine that we are breathing in and out. Air is going in and out. Air is contacting this cell. Blood is contacting this cell and flowing by it. And those physical motions are absolutely critical for respiratory physiology, for lung function. So we're not trying to build an artificial lung. We're trying to distill it down to its minimal biological design principles so that we can build a synthetic system that would recapitulate some class of functions that we feel are critical to be able to study or develop drugs or mimic physiology. So if I were to distill down to the minimal principles of an organ, what makes an organ? Well, organ are two or more tissues that come together where new functions emerge. Often a lining cell or epithelial cell and a blood vessel, or what we call a parenchymal cell, like a liver cell and a capillary cell, a lung cell and a capillary cell, a kidney cell and a capillary cell. And the last principle is this idea of dynamic flow, and in the case of the lung, cyclic breathing motions. So we put this all together and we developed a chip. I think I have one here, but you probably can't see it at a distance. Well, I will pop it out here just so you see the size of it. Can you turn the light on for one sec? Or actually, maybe. It's this little clear rubber device the size of a computer memory stick. It's flexible. I could bend it like this. Okay? But I'll show you in this a video of how this works. You'll see a picture at the top right. Okay, so if you cut this in cross-section, it has three little hollow channels that are each less than a pencil lead wide, or less than a millimeter wide. The middle channel has a membrane splitting the top in half with engineered pores that are the size big enough to let a cell go through, about 5 microns. We then take human lung lining cells on the top, human lung capillary cells on the bottom. We just recreated that interface, alveolar capillary interface. Then the trick is we have side chambers where we have cyclic suction. The whole thing's flexible. These walls stretch and relax, and it undergoes the same breathing motions as you're breathing at this very moment. We then can flow air over the top to create what's called an air-liquid interface, like in our lung, and we can flow medium through the bottom. I'll show you at the end, we now could flow whole human blood through these devices, in fact. Now, if this were to mimic organ-level function, then it should be able to model something like inflammation. Imagine you have a lung infection, bacteria. When they bind to the air lining cells, they produce factors called cytokines that induce inflammation by activating the blood vessel cell to pull circulating white blood cells out. They migrate across and they engulf. And that's homeostasis. That keeps us protected. So this is real pictures to the device. The white dots are white blood cells, and they're fresh because I took them out of my postdoc. You can't see the endothelial cells, they're black, and the epithelium, the lining cells on the other side. So you just saw that they flowed by and it's normal. But if you have bacteria, there's that signaling and they get inflamed and it pulls the white blood cells out of the circulation. Now you can do any imaging that you could do in a culture dish. So this is one white cell. About here, it's going to find a space between two capillary cells. It goes in, under, finds this matrix hole, filled hole. It wiggles its rear end through, goes out of focus, and now you can see it come out the other side by different imaging. And I'm going to show you now bacteria in green using green fluorescent protein, and the white blood cells are red, and you see them being engulfed. So you just watch the entire human inflammatory response at high resolution in real time in this little rubber chip. This got people's attention. Thank you. We're just starting, guys. We're just starting. Okay, so, you know, this really, I make it sound simple, but this really was, you know, involves incredible design. Dan Ho was the postdoc. It involves like figuring out ways that you can make these very thin membranes and pores and merge them together. And we had to etch out things to make the hollow channels. And actually, it's so novel, it was patented. And this is very important if you ever want to commercialize this, which we actually have done. Okay, so when I started this, I had a grant that was around nanotoxicology, which is what the public is, you know, really fears, and I think even I fear sometimes, that people were discovering that nanoparticles that people were putting in, you know, cosmetics, clothing, that so you hold your creases in your pants, that they were getting into the body and getting across barriers that you never think things that are 100 nanometers should get across, like the blood-brain barrier, the seminiferous tubules, and the testis. It was very, very strange. As a cell biologist, it didn't make sense to me. So the most, many of them come in through the airborne particulates, through air. So we basically developed a model with the lung. We had the lung chip you just saw. We used simulants of smog, air nanoparticulates in smog. There are actually 12 nanometer silica particles that people in the field use. We, in biology, we can develop probes that are fluorescent, meaning they give off a light, a colored light. In this case, when you have free radicals or reactive oxygen species that cause injury. And so we could quantify the injury response induced by particles on the chip. And you see the data here, and it's quite interesting. If you give the chip under static conditions without breathing motions, if you give it the nanoparticles, it doesn't do anything. If you give it breathing motions without nanoparticles, it doesn't do anything. But if you do both together, you see injury. So this would never be seen in a normal tissue culture dish, or even tissue culture dishes where they have cells growing on two sides of a static membrane. And so we actually could see injury, and if I move over, you could see that that induced immune cells sticking. So we actually induced inflammation in this chip. We can then quantify the absorption of these nanoparticles across the two cell layers and into the blood. It's like bioavailability of a drug, to be analogous. And what we can see here is that without breathing motions, very few get absorbed. But with physiological breathing motions, we got an 8 to 10-fold increase. This was not tearing holes in the membranes. Other proteins didn't get across. This appeared to be specifically transported by the cells across one cell, through the matrix, across the other, and out. And so I think this is how nanoparticles get across barriers that we never thought they could. Now, this is not mimicking physiology. This is a prediction. No one's ever seen this before. So we developed a model in a mouse where you could actually take those same particles, nebulize them, put them into the nose, and we could at the same time control their lung movements, whether or not they're breathing, and we got the exact same 8 to 10-fold increase. And this is a full research article, a longer article in Science. And I think we've been told by people at government funding agencies and the FDA that this changed the paradigm and that all of a sudden they realized this is possible. Okay, we started to talk to pharmaceutical companies and they said, that's really amazing, but you know, the real problem for us is we can't model disease, human disease. You know, it's hard to get a mouse that has a chronic disease or has a disease that looks like us. And so other companies were interested in toxicology, that being able to predict the toxicity of a drug before it gets into human clinical trials. So we hit two birds with one stone, as we say in America. We developed a model of pulmonary edema, which is a lung disease people call fluid on the lungs. But we did it using a cancer drug that's used clinically called interleukin-2, IL-2, and its dose-limiting toxicity is pulmonary vascular leakage that causes fluid filling the lung, airspace in the lung, coming out of the blood vessel. So if you look with air above the lining cells, the alveolar cells, this is what it looks like at time zero. If you give the drug The same way as in patients, intravenously, meaning we inject it in the vascular channel, what you see is that 2 days there's liquid like a meniscus filling the upper channel that over 4 days completely fills it with fluid. This is exactly the same time course at the exact same dose that fluid on the lungs is seen in patients who have toxicity with interleukin-2. We can then quantify it, and this is without breathing motions, this is with physiological breathing motions, and again, no one's ever seen this, and we actually, in vivo in that animal model, confirmed this is true in animals too. So this is important because clinically, most patients with pulmonary edema are in an intensive care unit on a ventilator, where you possibly can affect the mechanical breathing motions, which could be used therapeutically. But the other thing is that I mentioned I've worked for 40 years saying that mechanical forces are as important as chemicals and genes. And I actually have done basic research and worked out signaling pathways. And we identified an ion channel on the surface of cells that within 5 milliseconds after pulling on the matrix to which the cell is adherent induces calcium to go through this channel into the cell and to change their activities. And I heard that a company, GlaxoSmithKline, big pharma company, had worked on inhibitors of this channel, and they didn't fund our research, but we were able to get drug from them, and we tested it, and we completely inhibited pulmonary edema in this model. They then took this drug, and they tested it in dogs and rabbits in another form of pulmonary edema that's caused by heart failure. It's like back pressure on the lungs, and they got the same result, and we published back-to-back papers in a journal called Science Translation Medicine, very high-impact journal. And I think, again, this was the demonstration that really got a lot of people's attention. What was interesting in that paper is that one reviewer said this paper should never be published because it's too simplified, there are no immune cells. The other reviewer said, this is amazing because this is synthetic biology at the cell, tissue, and organ level. They just showed you don't need immune cells for pulmonary edema. And we eventually got it in. So, the thing about these models, we're not only mimicking physiology, we're learning that assumptions in medicine are often wrong because you can't study it in an animal or a human to really get at this in vivo. So this one organ on a chip, this lung chip we call the lung alveolus chip now, provided proof of principle for a human disease model, drug toxicity model, drug efficacy model. We've developed therapeutic targets. We've even developed drugs. That drug is now in phase 1 clinical trials. And that drug, I think, we were told the program was being shut down before this happened. So that, to me, is impact. I will say, I put this here, you know, just for those of you who are artists, this lung on a chip was a finalist in the Index Design Awards, which is the biggest international design award. I think it's 100,000 euros. We didn't win, but it was here in Copenhagen about 4 or 5 years ago, and that was the last time I was here in Copenhagen. But we won the International Design Award in 2015 at the London Design Museum comes out. We beat Frank Gehry buildings. We beat the Google car. We beat Mercedes-Benz new car. I mean, so it was cool. That was exciting. And then amazingly, this was acquired and exhibited at the Museum of Modern Art in New York, and it's acquired for their permanent collection, which most importantly means I am a permanent member of MoMA and don't have to ever pay to go, and I get discounts on food. So that's great, yes. So, we didn't stop there. So another drug company came and they said the big problems in for them in the pulmonary field are asthma and COPD, chronic obstructive pulmonary disease. Those are not diseases of the air sac, they're diseases of the small airway. So we took our chip, we made it taller, 1 millimeter high, which is the radius of a small airway or bronchiole, and we took human bronchiolar small airway lining cells, epithelial cells, and we cultured them on top for 3 weeks in vitro at an air-liquid interface while feeding them through the capillary channel, just like the way our lungs are fed through the capillary. In vivo, this is a picture in your body, they call it a pseudostratified epithelium. The cells are kind of look like multi-layered, and they have cilia and they have mucus. So they're a mucociliated epithelium. And as you know, the cilia and mucus are important for clearing particles out of your lungs and smoke and so forth. So if we put them on the chip for 3 weeks, this is what they look like. The green, they're a pseudostratified epithelium. The red on the opposite side of the blue membrane are the capillary cells. If you now stain them in white, for cilia and magenta for mucus across that whole millimeter channel, incredibly differentiated. They've got cilia, they're producing mucus, but more importantly, they're functional. This is side view and top view. Those cilia are moving, and they're moving in a directional way. If you take a little fluorescent particle and you put it on top, you can quantify mucociliary clearance, which is how our lungs are clearing all the time. This is real time. This is exactly the same rate that mucus is moving in your lungs right now, if you cough, because I'm saying it. And so if you look at this, if you look at the different cell types and their percentages, if you look at the cilia structure down to the electron microscopic level and the beating frequency in the blood, they're absolutely identical. This is a little small airway inside one of those little rubber chips. So we then started to work with other companies. I think this was with, we published a paper with Merck and Pfizer, two different competing huge pharma. It's like one of the things I'm most proud of. One funded the asthma work and one COPD. Is there a question there?
Yes, I was wondering, mucus, what does it actually consist of?
Mucus are made out of long, no, there's an exciting question. it's really a good question. Nobody ever, it's like, we know there's mucus. Is when it's healthy, it's made of long sugar chains, carbohydrate chains, like jello type materials, except like agar is a long carbohydrate material. And they're called glycosaminoglycans or mucopolysaccharides, but they're just, you know, if you're sick, then you have immune cells in there and other things, but they're secreted by the cells and they form a nice goopy viscous coating. Okay, so I think this was with Merck, I'm sorry, with Pfizer. We wanted to model asthma. The way they model it in animals is they use a cytokine called IL-13. So we treated our chips with IL-13, and the chips produce many more goblet cells. Those are the cells that actually produce mucus, and in asthma, they have a thickened mucus. They put out different inflammatory molecules. I won't go into their names. They decrease the beating frequency, so there's less clearance of mucus, and we can mimic this all on the chip. If you then, we then started to model viral infection, and we used a simulant of virus because we didn't have approval to study real viruses in the beginning. It's called poly-IC, but just think of it as viral infection. And what you can see here is quite interesting. These are the inflammatory mediators that are produced. And in this red box, this light gray bar is if you just have the lung lining cell alone, without the capillary cells, you get a little bit of inflammatory mediator. If you just have the capillary cell without the lining cell, you have a little bit of inflammatory mediator. But when they're together, so when you go from a tissue on a chip to an organ on a chip, now you have this reciprocal amplification, and now you get, and this is known to happen in vivo, and you could see that on these chips. So we now use real viruses. So this is human H1N1 influenza, you know, cause of the pandemic a few years ago. We can see infection on chips. But I want to show you where we're going with this. So the next slide, this is a GFP, a green fluorescent protein. You can genetically put GFP into any protein you want, and all of a sudden it becomes green and fluorescent. You could watch it. So we've made the virus here fluorescent. And when I click my button here, you're going to see virus added, and you're going to begin to see it propagate an infection. So you're watching how it's infecting. But here we're analyzing the outflow of the chip through the blood vessel channel, and it's like taking blood samples every few minutes. And we've developed miniaturized nanoliter electrochemical sensors so we can measure 64 different things simultaneously, like for those in science, in biology, like cytokines, inflammatory mediators, growth factors. And so you're going to see two of these inflammatory mediators. So I'm going to click it. So boom, we had the virus. And this inflammatory mediator goes up just as it's beginning infected, but this doesn't do anything. And then 24 hours later, this is coming up. And then this is going down and up and down. Now, normally we would collect once every 24 hours. But with this, we can actually begin to get a feel for what is going on in the process. And imagine 64 of these. This cannot be done in animals, this cannot be done in humans. You can't just constantly be analyzing everyone. It'd be a huge expense if you could do it. So then we made chips with cells from patients that have a disease, COPD, chronic obstructive pulmonary disease. And we put, these are small airway cells from the patients, When we put them on the chip, we keep them alive, for differentiate them into that the layer with the cilia, look very similar for 3 weeks. But we could begin to measure functions, and it doesn't matter what these are, but they're called TOLR receptors. They're known to be down-modulated in patients with COPD. We could see that they retain the phenotype in vitro after 3 weeks. So what brings COPD patients to the emergency room are exacerbations by things like a viral infection, a bacterial infection, or cigarette smoke. That's never been modeled in vitro. You can't really model it in a mouse. It's very, very hard. So we basically took healthy chips and COPD chips, and the poly-IC is mimicking viral infection. LPS is known as endotoxin. It mimics viral infection. And you can see that this inflammatory mediator doesn't change in healthy chips, but they go up, particularly in this bacterial infection. This cytokine goes up, whereas this cytokine only goes up in a viral infection in COPD, not in normal. And these don't really change differently. So we actually have developed a new biomarker that you potentially could use in the emergency room to see if a patient with a history of COPD is there because of a viral infection or a bacterial infection. Postdoc on this, Cambus Benham, got really into this, and he then developed a cigarette smoking robot. Oh, before I do that, we work with Merck to look at drugs, and we could see their effects on anti-inflammatories. So he worked on a cigarette smoking robot. This is more fun. Okay, so this is a cigarette lighter from a car. These are real cigarettes on a Gatling gun that rotates around. We have a machine that controls the breathing interval, the puff interval, the rate, the intensity. And we have cigarette smoke going right to the airspace of that airway chip. Normally, scientists study cigarette smoke by forming an extract in medium and then putting medium on. It's nothing like we do in vivo. It's well known in humans that how you smoke matters. So we can control that. So we now took normal chips and chips from patients with COPD who are known to be more sensitive to smoke. And you can see toxicity of the cells, injury, much higher in the COPD chips. Stress, much higher. Inflammatory mediators, no change in normal, big change in these cells. Then we did what are now, you know, genomics. We do gene microarrays. So we're analyzing thousands of genes across these patients. The three lanes at the right are from our chips, three different patients. These, God bless you, these are about nine different patients that were published 10 years ago in a study where they analyzed the gene expression across normal patients who smoke versus normal with or without smoking history. And the blue, the two different colors above and below are whether they go up or down, and you can see in general across all these different genes, we look pretty similar to the patients, but we are much more reproducible in what we get, much narrower range. Again, one reviewer said this shouldn't be published because, you know, we're getting this very narrow range where these patients don't look that much like that in terms of the regularity. And we went back and we realized that we could do things they can't do easily in a clinical study. We could do matched comparative modeling of the same patient before or after a stimulus, in this case smoking, and we get very good reproducibility. Where in this study, some patients smoked Marlboros, some smoked Galois, some worked in a radium mine, some people had asthma, I mean, you know, and so forth. So you get much more variability, and so this actually turns out to be something, again, you could do better in these chips than you could do in many clinical studies. We went on and we developed a human gut on a chip with peristalsis. So we took the chip, we made it wider, higher. We gave it trickling flow on the top, on the epithelial lining that's like gurgling fluid in your gut. And we basically gave it peristaltic-like deformations in terms of frequency. We took a cell line that the pharmaceutical companies have used for 50 years, originally came from a tumor of the intestines, that they hate because they say they're very poorly differentiated. They don't look anything like a liver, like a intestine. Intestines have villi. The cells are tall shaped, vertical, like a Coke can shape. These cells, they put them on a membrane that has pores, and they grow flat, almost like a skin cell. But they do form junctions and a barrier so they can measure absorption of oral drugs in vitro. And they don't like it, but it's what they use. We took these cells that for 50 years grow flat and don't look very good. We gave them peristaltic motions and trickling flow. Oh, by the way, to get a barrier in the way pharmaceutical companies do it in static culture takes 3 weeks. We put peristalsis and flow, and in 5 to 7 days, they spontaneously form villi, like in your intestine. This is looking in the chip from above, these crenulations. A villus is a very particular structure. There are proliferative stem cells in the crypt that grow, then they move up and they differentiate in your small intestine into 4 cell types. If we label cells to see what the ones that are growing, they're in the crypts. If we wash it out, they move up just like they do in the intestine, and we could show all 4 lineages. This is, at the bottom, is barrier function at 3 weeks the way pharma does it. This is 5 days the way we do it. I'm just focused. This is a drug metabolizing enzyme activity called P450. Never seen in 50 years on these cells. We have high levels, very important clinically. Your intestine metabolizes drugs. And this is mucus production. Never seen before in these cells. We get high levels of mucus production. Now, because we have flow and differentiation and mucus production, we could do what is maybe one of the more important things we've done, which is we can grow microbiome in contact with living human cells. So you've heard about microbiome is one of the major paradigm shifts in medicine in the last 10 years, right? That the microbes that live in your gut, your skin, your lungs, all over your body are responsible for your normal health and diseases. You could literally take the microbiome from your gut in an animal. You could take it from an animal with a disease like multiple sclerosis and put it in another animal and they get sick, or you could heal animals. This is definitely happening in humans as well in terms of various diseases. But you can't study it. They do it genomically. They kill the bugs and they just look at their genes. Because if you put microbes on cells, we call it contamination, they die. But we used Lactobacillus GG, which is a probiotic you could buy in the drugstore or apothecary. It's in yogurt. It originally came from a human gut. That's how they isolate it. If we put it in a static culture the way pharma does it, in 24 hours they die because it's contamination. This is measuring the barrier function. When we put it in our chips for weeks, they grow in symbiotic, happy relationship, and we get better barrier function, which is probably why people take probiotics. More recently, we're growing 8 different strains, and you can see very carefully, look, they're moving and squiggling, and they're living between those villi in the bottoms where they live in the body. And if you do gene analysis, if you analyze 22,000 human genes, which gives you a map of functionality, and it's done in duplicate here, if you look, Transwell is static culture the way pharma does it. If you put them in our chip, they're totally different genes expressed. They're totally different cells. If you now add the VSL3 is 8 different probiotic microbes, they're totally different cells, and they're getting closer and closer to human ileum, which is part of your intestine. So I often say to my students that there are no bad cells, just like there are no bad kids. You know, they may get into a bad group of friends and have problems, but if you bring them home, everything's okay. Now, if you put pathogenic bacteria that cause disease, they completely overgrow. And then we develop models of inflammatory bowel disease where we can show that if you look from the side, those are those villi. If you give an invasive E. coli bacteria, you lose the villi, and down here you lose the barrier function, that red line. But if you give endotoxin, which is produced by bacteria, actually alone it didn't injure the intestine. But now we could add another layer of complexity by adding immune cells, white blood cells. When we do that, now you get injury even with this endotoxin. So now we learned that it's like distilling down a problem to its minimal essential elements. It's like going, if you break down to a molecule, if you break it further, you get atoms that don't predict what the molecule does. So we're breaking this down to minimal system that has functionality of the system. And then if we don't see it, we realize we're missing something, we have to search for it. But if we do see it, we realized that the assumptions that you needed complexity is wrong. So the other thing is we can measure the outflow of the blood vessel channel, and in this case, the lumen, and we look for 12 different inflammatory molecules that have been implicated in inflammatory bowel disease clinically. And what we found is only when you get injury here, you get 4 different inflammatory mediators. I won't go into their names. But we can measure the concentration of them in the blood vessel channel. We could add them back one at a time, two at a time, three, four. And only when you had that combination of four do you get injury. So we're beginning to understand or be able to analyze the multi-component interactions that are responsible for disease, which is really how medicine works. It's not one thing. It's a complexity. We also could actually show that probiotics can protect against this somewhat. And this probiotic we used is actually had been shown in clinical trials to actually help with barrier function. And then finally, when I was in medical school, I remember that when a patient had surgery and had anesthesia, you have to get them eating as quickly as possible. Because if they don't get peristalsis back soon, you could get what we call ileus, which means bacterial overgrowth and people get sepsis and die. And I always tried to, like, people think it's because the flow stops. But I'm mechanically minded, and I wondered if like peristalsis could be important. So in the body, you can't stop peristalsis without stopping flow. But in our chips, we could stop the peristaltic motions but keep the flow. And it turns out it's the peristaltic motions that suppress the growth of bacteria. So again, we've learned something new that you would never learn any other place. I won't go through this deeply, but I know there are a couple of people from some pharma companies. This is in review. We developed a human kidney glomerulus on a chip. That is the part of your kidney that forms urine. This is where drugs are cleared. This is where it's very important for drug levels, because if the drug goes out, levels go down. And so we did this there are two cell types here. On the top are things called podocytes that in your kidney put little processes down to the extracellular matrix that's just beneath the blood vessel cells. And it forms a boundary that has selective filtration. We couldn't find a source of these podocytes because none of them were functional. So we developed our own iPS technology. iPS is induced pluripotent stem cells. You've probably read about this in the press. I could take any one of your skin cells or blood cells. I can give it a few different genes and a few different factors, and I could make them become stem cells again. And then I could induce those stem cells to become lung or liver or kidney or whatever. And no one has ever made these cells from them. So we developed our own way to do that with over 90% efficiency. We put them on the top. We took the capillary cells from the glomerulus, put them on the bottom. And we get an interface that's functional, but only when we give it one deformation per second, just like every time your heart pumps, the glomerulus actually deforms a little. You could watch this under microscopy. Then you can see, let's see over here, you could see these foot processes go through the pores in the membrane, and we greatly increase, maybe visible here, those are the pores going through the membrane. And over here, this is the glomerular filtration rate of our chip, and this is what it is in vivo. So we now get glomerular filtration on these chips. Finally, we now grow the capillary cells on all four sides, and we can now flow whole human blood without any anticoagulant. This is human blood flowing through it. If you take one of these channels, people have studied blood clot formation in microfluidics for a long time. What they do is they put extracellular matrix on the bottom without cells. And when you do that, as you see here with the platelets labeled in red, they stick and form a clot right on the matrix. This is like if you have an injury, the cells are removed, the matrix stimulates platelets to activate and form a clot. If you put the blood vessel endothelium, the capillary cells, they're protective, just like in the body. And as I showed you before, with white cells flowing by, here, I think it's going, it should be going, the whole blood is just flowing by, so you don't see any clot formation. But if you give an inflammatory stimulus, and it's a molecule called TNF-alpha to model it, but if you have inflammation, now you get a blood clot. But it doesn't stick and stay, it actually migrates. Like, platelets are coming off here and binding here, and coming off here and binding here, and it's moving across, and I don't know why I have a Mickey Mouse hand there, sorry. So, if you image this visually with color to show the dynamics, you can see that it's a teardrop shape, which you've never seen before in vitro. But we actually went in vivo with clinical group, Bruce Fury at Harvard, and this is what it looks like in vivo. So we actually reconstitute this pattern that's not seen before. So we now have made a lung alveolus on chip. We have primary cell lung lining cells, just like I showed you earlier, but we have the capillary on all four sides. And we gave the chip that molecule endotoxin that bacteria put out that actually can kill you. And a big part of killing you is blood clots, okay? But what we found is if we put them into the blood vessel directly, there's no blood clot. But if we put them into the lung airspace side, the lung lining cells put out inflammatory mediators that activate the blood vessel to then form a blood clot. And that's what you see here. So we begin to see organ level regulation that you could not normally see. So to pull this all together, I had a review last year in a journal called Cell. This really is synthetic biology at the cell, tissue, and organ level. You start with one cell type, like the lining cell, and you see, does it mimic physiology? If no, then you could add the capillary blood vessel. If no, you could add microbiome. If no, you could add immune cells. Then you could add pathogens. And you begin to add complexity, like I said, and begin to tease out how things work in a way that we cannot do before. Now, we have over 10 to 15 different human organs on chips at this point. We have cancer, and like lung cancer and lung chips, lung cancer and liver chips, like metastases. We've got blood-brain barrier. We've got heart. But many years ago, I said, because we have a blood vessel channel, we could create what's basically an integrated human body on chips. So you can imagine you give an oral drug through the lumen of the gut chip, pass it through the blood vessel channel to the liver chip, see if the drug is metabolized, watch it be peed out by the kidney chip, see the remaining drug, does it cause toxicity in the heart, and you know, do you affect bone metabolism, or aerosol drug in the lung, the same sort of way. And amazingly, we got a grant, $37 million grant from DARPA. DARPA funded the internet, it used to be called the ARPANET. They're tasked with America to keep America ahead by 30 to 50 years technologically for the defense of the United States. I always love that. So I won't go into why they funded it, but the challenge they put out was to build, well, it was about pandemics, and that they realized with the pandemics there's no way we could develop drugs quickly, and also economically that all the big pharma biotech were really failing. So that's the reasoning. So the challenge was to build 10 different human organ chips and an automated instrument that could keep them alive for a month and functional to mimic how functioning organs respond to drugs in the body. And we'd also have to do computational modeling of pharmacokinetics, pharmacodynamics, which is drug, how the drug levels and distributions occur in the body and their efficacy. So this is an automated instrument that we actually use robots, robotic arms, to take samples from one chip to the other rather than tubing, because we can change the order around, we could take samples out to analyze those inflammatory mediators, and we can basically quickly change, you know, whether we want lung, liver, heart, or heart, lung, liver. And we, as of last year, we've linked 8 different organs, kept them alive for 3 weeks on this instrument, and we could show we maintain the functionality. I'm not going to go into all this. And we could actually do pharmacokinetic models, and we could show the predictions work pretty well. And we're now working on what's called in vivo to in vitro extrapolation, being able to extrapolate from what we see in this, maybe what drug to start in a clinical trial. So this is, it's not totally there yet, but it's feasible. And we're making headway. So to end, the game changer to me is right now pharmaceutical companies spend tens of millions of dollars, many years, they'll do a big clinical trial, and they almost always fail. Then they get statisticians to do number crunching on the results, and they hope that maybe there's a small subgroup, maybe a genetic subpopulation, that responded better. And if they find it, they design a small clinical trial, and then they hopefully get approved for a narrow application. With organs on chips and that IP, that induced pluripotent stem cell technology, you can imagine, you know, a group of women from Denmark who are asthmatics, who are ultra sensitive to cigarette smoke, and you can make 100 chips from those women, and you could develop a drug for those women, and you could use those women in your small clinical trial. Now, if that works, you have decreased the timeline, dramatically decreased the cost, and dramatically increased the likelihood of success. I think that's the sort of thing that's going to see with these. You're also going to see people in personalized medicine, where you're going to see at the very wealthy hospitals that they're, to begin with, you know, they're going to collect your cells, make chips from them, and test your drug against you to determine which of these 5 drugs is the best and which may be the least toxic. Now, this is also useful for chemical testing, for radiation testing. It doesn't have to be human. You could imagine pesticides. You could have a human gut on a chip, a cow gut on a chip, and an insect gut on a chip, and like find pesticides that preferentially kill the insect and don't affect cattle or man. And so this is something that is being used for the food industry with microbiome. And I have to tell you that you cannot believe anything I said, because we formed a company called Emulate, and I have equity, and I'm on the scientific advisory board, so ignore everything and have a good set of drinks tonight. But luckily, most of this was done before the company formed. But the company is hopefully gonna have its first products being sold around the world, automated instruments and chips that are very simple that you could put your own cells in the next, hopefully, 6 months. Can't do this without really crossing disciplinary boundaries and bringing people from every discipline that you can imagine. And the Wyss Institute is kind of an amazing place. We not only have incredible scientists, we have over 40 people from industry with 10, 20, 30 years in product development experience that are integrated with the teams. That's how we're able to do all this kind of translational type stuff. And this organs on chips is just a tip of the iceberg at the Wyss Institute. We have 18 core faculty, we're 8 years old. We have 1,800 patents. We have had a science or nature paper every month since the day we formed in 2009. And we have 18 startups and many licensing deals. And so to the end, I invite you to our website. We won the Webby, the Academy Award of the Internet for the best science website a few years ago. We beat out Wired Magazine and NASA Space Propulsion Lab. We got bored with it, so we just done a new website, and we're a finalist for the Webbies again. So I invite you to come. With that, I will end. Thank you so much, and I hope you enjoyed it.